Now, first take a look at this basic diagram, and which should help us to understand how block works and how could we make a post request to the server. So this would be our UI, and from UI we'll access to the block, and as we access to the block, actually would trigger events, and events would eventually trigger state. But anyway, so first over here, as events are triggered, it would talk to the repositories or repository files that we'll have in our application, and that would talk to the server. Now, events would actually call a method. So what it means that from UI, we are going to call a method. Those methods would be called through events. Now, what method? Actually, those methods would stay in our repository. And what kind of method they should be? They should be actually more like our method to the server that would post data. So we will post data to the server using this repository. So that would be inside our app. And as we do that, the data would be gone to the server. We'd deliver the data to the server. And then, of course, we might get a response back from the server. And then as we get it, would first talk to the event, and event would trigger states. And as we have new states, the new states would redraw the UI based on the response from the server and repository, like that. So this is how it should work. So now from this basic diagram, we understand that. So first we have to look at the server and then the repository, and based on that, we'll create events, and after that, we'll create states. And using both event and states, we'll create our block. And once we have block ready, then we'll connect it to the UI so that our block and UI will be able to communicate. Eventually, we'll have very smooth communication from UI to the block, to the repository, to the server. Okay, so let's go ahead and take a look at the server first. To be able to work with the server here, I'm going to use Firebase Server. This is a server that's already there and everybody can have access as long as you have a Google account. Anyway, so here I have this Firestore database. So we are going to use Firestore database to store our data. Okay, all right. And so you have to go ahead and create a Firebase project. And then, of course, you can create your apps. So for now, I'm going to go ahead with Android. Anyway, so once you have that one from build method, you have to create a Firestore database, which I have already done it. So it shows up over here. And after that, you have to change the rules a little bit. Over here, first time, the default rule should be false. So we'll change it to true so that we are able to read and write to our database. Okay, and that's it. All right. And now we are going to create collections. So we know that collections are more like MySQL database tables. So we'll go ahead and create a table. So our table name should be products. You can name it anything you like, and that's it. Now, so in the table, we'll have rows. Those documents are the rows. So rows have ID in MySQL, like 1, 2, 3, 4. So over here, we also have ID. So here we'll auto-generate ID, okay? So this is our row name or row ID. And we know that row contains fields. So over here, first field will have name. And over here, the value could be anything. So for now, we could say shirt. So now we'll have price, and price, the type is string. Actually, you could go ahead with string. A lot of people might do it number. And we'll have a default value for 10, okay? Now, as you see over here, so we have this table. In the table, we have one row, and it has two fields, which is name and price. So this is our Android Studio, and to be able to work with this, since we are going to use block, you have to go ahead and install this three plugins. One is Flutter BLoC and this Equitable, and then we have to work with this Cloud Firestore. Okay, so first we have seen from the picture that we had to work with the data server, and we already did that. So our server is set up and ready. So now we need to go ahead and create repositories. So here my product repository class, and inside this we have created a collection. Actually, this is the collection that we created in our backend, and over here we are referring to it. So what's happening here, you are more like referring to this Firebase tables over here, okay? All right, and what we want to do over here, we have a create method. Now this is the method that we want to call from our UI using block events. Now inside this, we have this try close section, as you see that. Now over here, we are calling an add method. So this add method actually posts data to the server, okay? So it's a little bit different than classic post method, where you can see that it says post or post data or post items. But in Firebase, in this case, actually, this is pretty much add. Okay. Now, anyway, so it would take two arguments. One is name and price. So we're going to send them from UI through events. Okay. And after that, if we have any exception, we catch them in two places and we see if we have error or not. So over here, we created this repository class and this is our method. Okay. So once the method is ready, now we'll be able to connect them from our block. One thing though, if you don't use Firebase, actually this should be your endpoint as well, because if you work with those traditional servers like Linux servers or Windows servers, so from here actually you'd pass data to your server. So from here you'll call the endpoint, okay? And as you call it, you'd pass the data the same way I'm doing it over here. Okay, in that case, you might have to use HTTP package to post data, but here I'm not doing that. This is the time we go ahead and create events. Here we have this abstract class, and abstract class is extending equitable. Now we use equitable to check if two events or states are same or not, okay? And so since this is an abstract class, we have to create another class that extends the abstract class. So we are extending over here product events. Now here it's quite important that we also have a constructor over here. Now this is the event or event class that would get called from our block. So you have to know that in Flutter, events are in Flutter block, events are represented using classes. Okay. So in here events, you have to understand that's a class. Okay. All right. So as you see that over here, we have name and price. So our events would get called from UI. So as it gets called, we'll assign name and price to it. Okay. And which also corresponds to the name and price over here. So over here, we created a new Dart file, which is called app states. And we know that just like events in Flutter, states could also be represented using classes. So that's what we are doing over here. So we have this abstract class. And then based on that, we created an initial state class. The class's name is initial state. And this would get called from the block. As we create a block, we have to supply parameters to its super constructor. And at that place, we'll call it, and which is must. Whenever you create blocks, you have to give something to the super constructor. And this is where it would go. And now this class also represents a state. Now this would get called when the data is trying to be submitted to the server, as we try to add data, post data. So then it would get called. And as the data has been successfully posted, then this state class would get called. And then if we have error, we'll have this one. Okay, so we'll call this state. Of course, if we have error, then we have to send some data and we'll work with the data. So that's why over here in the constructor itself, we grab the data. Well, we have created events and state. So based on this two, we can go ahead and create block. So this is our class, which is called product block and which extends block. Now this block is coming from Flutter block, and which takes events and state type. So the events, the one we created earlier, and this is the state. So you have to apply them as you use Flutter block. And now at the same time in the super constructor, in the constructor itself, we are going to inject the repository, the one that we created early. So as we call this block from the UI, and as you see from the picture that this block would get called from the UI, right? This is our UI, this is our block. So as we do that, actually, we have to supply this value, which is called product repository of this type, of product repository type. So we have to assign that. So that's why we grab it over here and assign it to this constructor, and we initialize it. And as I said earlier, that as you create a block, you in the super constructor, you have to give a value. So here is our value, initial state, the initial state class, the one that we created early. Okay, so there has to be a state for super constructor. I mean, there has to be a value for super constructor, and that is a certain state. And after that, actually, we register our events. So the event's name is create over here, as you can see. Okay, so this is the event that we register. So it's more like you're binding a method. Okay, so this would actually get called from the UI, not really this one. Of course, this is a constructor. So this event would get called, and the event's name is create, we'll call it from UI, okay? And it takes two parameters, one is event and image. Now, the first state we do is called product adding, okay? So we are emitting this one. As we emit, this would be available on the UI side, and we can find it, and we can use if else statement to work with that, do some other things. And then we call this future delayed, and this is not necessary. You can skip that if you want, but it gives us the feeling that we are submitting data to the server. Otherwise, it happens too fast, okay? Once again, this is optional. And then we have this try close method, and inside this try catch, I'm sorry, we are calling our repository which triggers endpoints, okay? Because in our repository we have a method which is called a create. So this is the create method that we are calling from our blocks, okay? So as you see that this is our block, and from block we call a repository, and this is how you call it, okay? So you have to call the repository, the methods inside the events, the event you create, okay? And then this would go ahead and post the data, and it's posting data using this event, because events carries some values, which is name and price. So you have to assign that value to the repository, okay? Not through the state, you have to remember that. And as well as over here, if we successfully submit the data, then we can trigger another event, another state, which is called product added. And based on that, we can do some other things. And eventually, if we have error, we catch them and emit a new state. This is our homepage UI. And over here, we have a stateful class, which is called homepage. And inside this, we have this text controller, because we want to grab the data from the user. And we have two methods. One is called create method, and as well as post data method. And inside this, we have our build function, okay? So inside this stateless class, so this is our build function. Now, over here, if you run it, go ahead and run it, it would look like this, the UI, okay? So this is a basic UI. So what do you want to do? We want to click on this and be able to pop up a form like this. And then you want to be able to submit data. As you post on this, it'll submit data to Firebase, okay? So that's what we want to do. And the UI is already working. Now here, one thing though. So this is a model bottom sheet that we are using, okay? Now, where is this coming from? As you can see, so we do have a floating action button over here. So this is our floating action button. And inside this, we have this create method. And this is the create method, okay? So now we'll open it up. And inside this create method, we have this show model bottom sheet. And this is nothing fancy. We also have this build method. And it's just returning this UI, which has this padding. Create the post method, okay? And once we do that, after that we clear up everything and we go back to the previous page. Oh, well, what is this post method? Now, from this post method over here, actually we want to call our events. Events would eventually call a method from the repository. Once again, just like this picture. So UI talks to the block and the block creates events, okay? Now, at the same time, of course, we have to be able to access our block from this method, okay? What will happen, actually we'll create the block over here in our main.dart file, and then we'll be able to access it from here. Now this is the time we go ahead and work with this main.dart file. So over here we'll inject our block, and then that block would be available to the file itself as well as the child file or the child widgets, okay? So we have some changes in the main.dart file, so we are going to initialize Firebase. Until we initialize, our app should wait. And as well as, since we are going to use a repository in my app over here, we are injecting our own repository using repository provider, so which is coming from block itself, so which also means that we are going to work with this network, okay? So that's why over here we are using repository provider. And inside this, we created another class which is called home, okay? Now inside this home class, actually we want to create our actual, creating this scaffold key because we want to show over here a snack bar, but that's not very important. Now The real magic happens inside this return section, because over here, first time we create our block, okay? So to create a block, we are using block provider, and inside this, we inject our product block, the block that we created over here, the product block we created over here, and we inject it. And as we inject it, we need to give the value for our repositories, because over here we want to grab it, so then we want to call a method from our repository itself, okay? And right after this, the scaffold key, and then we also have this block listener. Now, one can say that we could do this thing without this block listener. Yes, possible, but the way I'm doing, because I want to also listen for some states that's changing, so that's why over here I'm using a block listener, okay? And inside this block listener, if things changes over here, we are going to show this snack bar, okay? As you can see, based on the product, based on this state, we are going to show a snack bar, okay? And right after this, actually, we are trying to look for our events and states, okay? Actually, we are trying to look for our states over here, so that's why we are using block builder, okay? Builder, you'd be able to listen to the changes, and as you see over here, we have if else statement, okay? So we are first time we are checking if we are adding products or not, and then if we have error or not, otherwise we just show the home page and which is our current state, okay? Because none of this states are being used right now. Now as you see, if you call this events over here, so the first will emit product adding, which refers to this one. So we'll emit that state. And if we do that, we can check it on UI. And then we'll show the progress bar. And after that, we'll talk to the server 1 second later. Okay. And if the data is successfully posted, then we'll emit another new state. And that state will listen. We'll just listen over here within block listener. And then we'll show this one. Okay. And if we have error, then we'll go ahead and use this. And you can ask me why I don't do this one inside this block builder, okay? Now with the block builder, you have to return a widget, okay? You have to return a widget if you want to make changes based on the state. But scaffold messenger, which shows a snack bar, this is not a widget, okay? So you can't return it from here. Okay, so one more step to go. So in general, default, we are returning our home page. And in the home page, we have this floating action button, okay? This calls the method, which is called create method over here. And eventually, create method over here returns, calls a post method, post data method. So as we call it, actually from here, we want to trigger our events. Now, we have to find the events from our block. And how do you find it? To find, you have to use block provider.off, okay? And as you do that, you can call or trigger any kind of event. So what is our event? Our event is create, okay? Okay, so here, post method would trigger events. And we are ready to go. Now, we do have one issue over here. Post it. And now we'll go ahead and verify if it worked or not. So yes, this is the new field. Now here we see bells and the price 20 created. So another one. And we see this is the new one. Let's click on this and it worked. Okay, all right, great. So it means it's already working. Here you have to know that as we click on this button, eventually this post method gets called over here, and which calls the event over here. Now this is the event over here, and after event is done, after the events gets called, we emit a state, and that state we check over here, and then we show the progress bar. Okay, and as we do it, our block delays 1 second, and after that it posts the data to the server, and it does, and after that it returns, and we have this product added. Now this product added, we listen over here, okay, and then we show the snack bar, and that's what was happening just now. Okay, so yeah, that's how it works.